Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today I will introduce you Azure Machine Learning Studio, the cloud service that provides Microsoft to accelerate and manage the machine learning lifecycle. The product is designed to help ML practitioners, data scientists, or machine learning engineers in all the phases of the machine learning lifecycle, from problems in inception up to monitoring. So you can do with the product or cover the different steps in the ML lexicon: data exploratory analysis, training or validating models, hyperparameter tuning, deploying the model to different endpoints, or even monitor and manage and govern the different models that you may have in your environment or you are producing. I prepare some demo here in Microsoft Azure. I'm assuming that you already have a subscription and you can enter in the Azure Azure dashboard, and we will not cover this part. If you are interested in me doing that, I will create a specific video to that, but well, it's pretty straightforward to create a subscription to Azure, and then well, for now we suppose that you have it, and then on we will just cover how to set up initially a service, a workspace, everything in a machine learning studio around the workspace. I will explain you later what is. And well, let's go. You go to your subscription. I already had one created, but well, you will see how to do. You go to a resource root. You can create one for this, or you can use an existing one you have. That will depends if you want this service to interact with other services like Data Factory, Databricks, Synapse, the Stories, etc. Some other services that you may have already created, and you want to have everything allocated on the same VPC, and well, that in this way you will not need to set up additional routing or firewall rules, etc. For this test, you can do that as you please. It's not necessary to. You can create a new one. It's not necessary to put it in a resource group, because what we are going to look at is at the different components at the inside the Machine Learning Studio, in what is possible to be done and not possible to be done. We will cover all the. Again, all the components, and well, we will not do any interaction. We will just describe what is possible with which technologies, which in principle is practically everything available in Azure that you can integrate or you can connect with Azure Machine Learning Studio. So we go to a resource. You just go create, and then here in the marketplace look search bar, you just write Azure Machine Learning, and then appears the service. You click on that, create, and then well, if you have a subscription, it's not, you cannot even get that. You can decide again, create a new resource group. It's not the one that from where you start the process. You get a name, whatever, it doesn't resist. You decide the region. Here I insist, like in other videos before, be careful with the region. Usually you should set up this in the same region where there are the other services that which you are going to interact with, because this way, first of all, you will not incur in additional fees for data cross-bordering, and secondly will be much more easier, because later if you had the resources in different in between different regions or in between different resource groups or different subscriptions is much more difficult later on establish connections and exchange data in between them. For this test, everything is going to be on the same resource group and subscription, but keep in mind that when you are going to deploy this in a company, in a corporation which may have distributed the services across multiple regions in different groups, this can be a little bit tricky. And in order to optimize and the cost and the and minimize the number of the different rules and connections, etc., that you need to do, it's better to first of all plan this carefully or even hand over this process, which usually is in charge of the people who is doing the infrastructure or the cloud engineering in the company. In this video, it doesn't really matter, just I'm going to describe you what is necessary to be done, but again, if you need to do those in a company, just bear in mind this kind of things, because at the end it could mean to have some extra costs that are not really necessary. So once you install Azure Machine Learning Studio, come with a requirement of the mini essentially one storage account, which is going to be used by Azure Machine Learning Studio to keep all the data produced, logs, all the tracking there for experiments, etc. Everything is storage in a storage account which is attached to the Machine Learning Studio. A key vault, which is where you will save all the keys, passwords, etc., service accounts, everything that is a credential is should be stored there in the key vault. So when once you created, additionally, you need to create a key vault. As you can see here, is giving you a name by default. If you have a name nomenclature in your company, follow that name nomenclature. If not, Azure will choose one for you. Application inside, for all login and monitoring, everything is sent to an application inside service, and similarly to the key vault storage account, is attached as a requirement, is mandatory to have one, and then on this later on it will help us to track problems or track what's going on in an experiment or where my data were deposited, etc., etc. And a container registry, here if you establish NOM, it will use a kind public repository that will be used temporarily just to create your container, because everything under the hood is working in Docker containers. All the steps that you will run later in a pipeline are running essentially in a Docker container, or you can set up a private one. This only is for you, obviously it has an additional cost, but this will use some kind of more privacy kind of the for the group or for the company or for the people who is going to use this technology. Then on there is additional tags that are more oriented to company or industry deployment or corporation deployment, where you may have, for example, not access to internet, or you had access to the Machine Learning Studio behind a reverse proxy. So we will take all of this by default, the encryption as well. So if you want to just use the default keys that produce the Microsoft, because everything is encryption at rest, or you can use the customer one per group, per company, etc. Again, identity, how to manage the authentication, and the authentication and the identification of every user, which roles are going to use when they are logging into the service, etc., etc. Again, for this test, they are not relevant because we are going to put everything by default. But in case that you are going to do this in a company, you will need to take care about that. To be honest as well, most of this stuff in the companies I've been working for usually is done by a team which is specialized in infrastructure deployment, and you just need to get them the requirements, what do you want, how many people is going to access, which roles, etc. So, but it's good to know, and in case that you are going to take the DP100, the certification, you need to know all these details as well. Tax, this is just to identify the service in Azure, and then on review and create. No, if there is something wrong, you will receive here a warning and something that something is not correct, maybe the name, maybe the whatever. Okay. And then if your validation is passed, just go create, and that's it. It will take the couple of minutes maximum, and you will have Azure Machine Learning Studio ready to go. Again, it's going to create minimally four services. One is the Azure Machine Learning Studio itself. The other three are the Stories account, the Key Vault, and the Application Insight. And if you decide to use the public, let's say public container service, is fine. It's nothing. We'll create one private attached to this workspace, and private and for only use of this workspace. I will not create it because I already have mine. And then we can go later to Azure Machine Learning, directly you will see here the results that you have been already created. In my case, I created in this region. Then you can click on that and you get the dashboard, the overview. And then you have here key details that you probably, especially you are going to use the service via code, with Python or with R or with C#, you will need these details, because again, everything that you will do is necessary to be authenticated against Azure, and you will need the resource root, the subscription, and also the name of the service. So minimally you will need the subscription, location and resource root, and obviously additionally some credentials, usually a service account or similar. Not is also, you can generate as well keys to access to the endpoint, etc. So you have here as well, as we set up this as public, we can access this using internet, so it's externally exposed. You can click just here, or you can just launch Studio. It's exactly the same. We launch that, and then we enter in Azure Machine Learning Studio. So at the time I'm recording this, Microsoft is launching what they say Microsoft. What is a Genitive Studio, which is Generative Studio, and then it's going to be the replacement of Azure Machine Learning Studio. So depending when you see this video, probably you will get the new let me show you. It's going to be easier sometimes. Yeah, exactly. So the new, 1 second, sorry again. So at the end, I found what they said. They are merging the conventional Azure Machine Learning Studio with Azure AI Services. It's a little bit confused now at the time I'm recording this video, but well, we will focus in the in the in what is how to say the service now, Azure Machine Learning Studio. But again, I later if you see this video probably in 1-2 months, let's take a look to how is organized at that time the service, because again they are changing, merging the services in everything under Azure AI services. And probably when you take the video, maybe you don't find some of the services with the same name. Okay, let's move again to the workspace. As I said, everything in Machine Learning Studio around the workspace. The workspace is a resource with a number of the dependencies, and it has access to different resources. So as we saw on the install, on the configuration of the workspace, you have some dependencies. This is all the resources that you need to create a workspace. The workspace is going to govern and manage all the activity that you do inside the service, and it will give you access to some other services, which they say linked services. You will be able to create what is clusters for running your experiments, to do your exploratory data analysis, and you will produce what they say assets, no? Environments, experiments, pipeline, data sets, models, and endpoints. No? So we will see this one by one. Expose what is everything, and yeah. Well, recently they include as well in Azure Machine Learning Studio access to different generative AI models. Difference with other providers like Vertex AI from Google or SageMaker from AWS. Well, here you can use not only OpenAI models, you can also use public models like Falcon or Mistral. You can see them here, and you can apply templates or your custom procedures to fine tune these models. If you remember the videos I published before in the channel about Vertex AI, you can only fine tune their own models here. They also give you the possibility to use any model that is available essentially in Hugging Face Hub. Also, you may know that Microsoft has an agreement with OpenAI, and they have this Azure OpenAI Studio, which you essentially interact directly with the OpenAI model, ChatGPT, GPT-4, GPT-3.5 Turbo, etc. This is another service we will look at there. You can also access to these models here in Azure Machine Learning Studio. And well, we will cover this in a separate video where we will speak about generative AI, how to train, fine tune a model, how you can do prompt engineering here as well, similar to the offering that we saw or I showed you in the previous videos. Pretty similar, as I say before in other videos as well, that the three main cloud providers, Google, Amazon, and Microsoft, well, have a really similar offering. The different names, slightly different in how they approach or the concept or approach a specific step into the machine learning lifecycle, but essentially are pretty similar. The advantage, as I said, here in Microsoft Machine Learning Studio, in Azure Machine Learning Studio, sorry, is that you have access, as you can see here, to any model that you may find in Hugging Face Hub, no? Which is really an advantage, no? Because if you remember when I make the video of Vertex AI, you have access to all the models. You can fine tune a foundation model, but only models from those providers, no? Okay, now we are going to go to all the components that we have here. Notebooks. This is a specific tool for a for data scientists, where they used to do modeling, is essentially is an interface to access to different tools like JupyterLab, Jupyter Notebook. Also, is integrated directly with VS Code, and you can work as well VS Code in web in a web application or VS Code in your desktop computer, in your local computer, fully integrated with via plugins provided by Microsoft. You can develop in your local machine, and you can publish your endpoint pipelines, etc., to Microsoft, and even run pipelines from your local computer. I will show you this in a different video, but it's possible to do. So essentially, this is the tool that is more orientated at data scientists, but because it's it contains Jupyter Notebooks, and also it's possible to have other tools for modeling like MATLAB via third party integration, or even RStudio. And usually this is the tool that the data scientists used to do. As they had this integration with VS Code, which also with the machine learning engineers or ML practitioners can use it that way. What usually you do is you create a computer. We'll see this in a second when we cover the section compute, or we can cover right now. No? We can jump here because we need to create an instance just to show you how the notebooks works. No? There is different computes. This is the type of resources that you can create or establish a connection to them from Azure Machine Learning Studio. And then you can create compute instances. This is the instances that are at the end is a VM from one of the templates that are available in Microsoft. We will look at this in a second. Compute clusters that are orientated. This is a number. This usually is a VM only with GPU or no GPU. Computer cluster is a number of VMs altogether is under a single entity, but they are multiple VMs with a single name. Kubernetes cluster, this is the AKS service where you can deploy usually endpoints for inference, and attached computers. Attached computers is any of these services that you can, link to your workspace and use it for some of the specific process in your pipeline. It can be, for example, Databricks. You can have notebook or notebooks that make some ATL process, and then this at the end is wrapped in a component, in a step in your pipeline, and then from here you will need to have a connection to this Databricks workspace where is residing these notebooks, and then this component it will be part of a bigger pipeline, and then it will be integrated in a position on that pipeline with some dependencies in on and out. And this essentially what it will do is once you run the pipeline, when we get the moment to run this component, which is linked to an Azure Databricks cluster workspace, it will run what you specify to run, and it will have an entry point, it has an input and an output. Usually this input and output is done in the storage accounts that are attached to the workspace, and it will continue to the next step. Usually I use this in other services just to, for example, you need to do an ETL process or a big transformation process where you had to read a lot of data and then on aggregate it in a final table. Probably it's better to do this in a Databricks cluster, because of performance, obviously, because you need to understand that here everything is running in VMs, and then on probably for big data this is not the best solution, and the best either is running in a Databricks cluster or in a Synapse pool, the Spark pool, or even in HD inside with these Spark clusters as well, or in one of the other services. I will explain you now what is the virtual machine. So from here, you just define the connection to this. Obviously, the service had to be created before establish the connection, and then once it's established the connection, you just define this link in one of the steps of your pipeline. If you have, for example, a already created a VN, it doesn't necessarily the VN doesn't need to be necessarily in Azure, can be in another cloud provider. For example, running a specific model that is not is custom done by your data scientist for any reason, whatever. You can have this in your VM, and then you can just connect this VM to the workspace, and it will be accessed via SSH. And then this way, SSH or HTTPS. And this way, once you have created the connection, it will be part or can be used as a part of your pipeline, as a component in your pipeline. We will see this later on. Okay, now we are going to create a compute instance to run the notebook. As I told you before, there is CPU or GPU instances depending on what you are going to run. Just for this example, we are going to create a CPU. You can choose a template depending what you are going to do. It's, again, this is more oriented for EDA. Also here something to remark is obviously the type of the VMs that you have available depends on the subscription you have. If you don't see for example machines or VMs with A100 GPUs attached, it's because probably you don't have enough quota to do this, no? And then you need to request a quota in case of you receive an error that not enough quota to create this service. And then you just give a name, you select what do you want, and well, you can establish a shutdown time or even a start computer time as well. Is a conventional schedule, if you want to say that, no? We leave it that. You can set up some other parameters. You can access the VN via SSH. To be honest, I'm very few times I use that. Why? Because usually you have the terminal in your Jupyter notebook, and you don't need to have this access, because you have the same access via terminal. But well, it's up to you. If you want to do. You can put this in a specific virtual VPC for privacy or to protect it, because it contains or you are going to handle sensible information. You can attach it to a specific identity because you just want to this compute instance to be used by specific users, and well, you can assign in this place to another users. Imagine that you are the person who is managing the workspace, because here in the workspace is a collaborative tool. You can have multiple users accessing to the same workspace with different roles, and then you can have the role that with higher with the higher access, no, with the admin access, and then you can be entitled to decide who access to who inside the workspace. We leave it like that, because again, with this one, is just show you what is possible to do. And then this, you can integrate the computer state instance with a third-party application like MATLAB, and then you can set up a script. For example, if you want to deploy again MATLAB, I think they removed RStudio. In the past, it was available by default. I think that now you have to set up the application as a third party application in the you have to specify implicitly that you want the application before it was by default. But again, you can you not only Azure Studio, you can do MATLAB or other Octave, for example, or whatever other application that you want to have available. At the end of the day, as I say, this is a VM with some software installed by default. It's an environment that is predefined by Azure, and then you can set that in top of this VM whatever. Whatever is possible at the end, because not everything is possible. But it's a Ubuntu or CentOS VM with GPU or no GPU support, depending on the template that you use, and on top of that you can set up other third parties applications. Tags, case that you want to add additional information just to localize the or categorize the resource, and then on review and create. We are going to create this. And then on, it will take a couple of minutes. Let's go automate ML. Well, if you are familiar with machine learning, this is a service that probably today most of the providers provide. No, is just to create a model. In this case, they are providing supervised learning and supervised learning. Time series analysis, NLP, and computer vision. With 3-4 clicks, you just decide the data set, the type of the experiment that you want to do, and decide attach the data, and that's it. The compute and review. So attach the infrastructure to this job, and review and submit the job. Automatically, as you may know, the workspace will try different algorithms with different scorings, with different imputation procedures, etc., etc. It will try. Probably, depending is you how many jobs you want to run, it will try different algorithms, as I said, and after that it will provide you a list of the outcomes that it got after running all these experiments. I don't use it too much. It's a good tool for I will say quick prototyping, or to establish a baseline. Is fine to establish a baseline of what you can get, but it's a kind of black box at the same time, because you don't know what's going on, what exactly is done by the service in under the hood, and then you have no control. You only get the inputs and you analyze the outputs. Again, somehow it can give you a grasp of the what you can get with your model, and to get quickly an output and a resource, maybe to evaluate the feasibility of the model, is a good tool, and you have it there. It's up to you to use it or not. Okay, now the notebook we have here. Sorry, you have here, and as I said you before. You have here JupyterLab, Jupyter, VS Code, VAWET, or VS Code Desktop, Terminal, a Notebook. Notebooks is this part that you get here, is directly attached. As I said before, again, now it's not by default R Studio. Before, months ago, it was a default tool that you can, it can automatically everything every time that you set up a compute instance. No? And then, well, going here, it's pretty straightforward. You just click in JupyterLab, and then you just go to your workspace, to your personal folder. And the personal folders are I don't need to show you this. Is probably everybody knows that this in notebooks this is exactly the same. that you have here. These folders, this workspace is leveraged on the storage account that it was attached to the workspace at the creation time. So later on, you can access everything you had in your personal folder. You can access as well to the common areas. You cannot access, obviously, to what other users, even you don't see it, to what other users are creating. But there is mechanisms to exchange information in between issues. Designer is well another tool which facilitates is kind of the you had multiple receipts or steps predefined by Microsoft, and you just need to create to put it all together in a collab. I will show you an example. For example, this is a regression model which had an input, also like in any other like Hugging Face or Databricks or PyTorch, you come with some data sets where you can just to experiment with. And then on the designer, well, you just simply take the activity, the tags, and you just put it into the canvas, and you just link the different tags, the input to it, the output of one to the input of the next. You can set up different tags in parallel. These tags, every tag will run in a different pod in your infrastructure. When I say pod, is a VM in your computer cluster. So if you had all your steps organized in a sequentially manner, you will just need one. But if you feel or you think that some of these processes can run in parallel, the Machine Learning Studio will automatically assign, if you had available VMs, every step to a different pod, a different VM. This means that the process will be speed up because of the parallel running. No? So what I want to say, you show you here, is just you had a number of different boxes or steps predefined. You just need to set up what you want to do. For example, in splitting the data, you have here the parameters. And then you can define how you want to do the split, the fraction, if you want to random, you want to set up a seed, stratified split, well, if you want to ensure that the different classes are a class is correctly represented in both splits, etc., etc. You define the output, the input. So this is an easier way as well, like AutoML. Here you have more control. You don't know exactly what's going on here, how is designed this component, but well, it's also a tool that will speed up a lot the prototyping of a model. No? You have here again some examples. You can run, it's pretty simple. You just configure and submit. Let's take a look at this. Experiment and submit. You create a new experiment. You give a name. This one. You click next. Input and output. If you decide you set up an additional input, you can have multiple inputs merge. There is a data transformation which merge the different columns. Even if you had, for example, steps that you can be just simply Python scripts which specify whatever you may want to do. For example, open a CSV file with pandas or open multiple CSV file with pandas merge all together or do some aggregations and output this in a temporary location to be read by the next step. This is the purpose of this input and output, no? So we don't have this in this example. There is no input and output. Additional, I mean, there is no additional input and output. Here you decide the computer cluster that you want to use. We don't have yet, so we will need to create it. And then the default data store, if you don't specify one, is the block, workspace block storage that is created at creation time. And if you don't specify other, it will be deposit all your artifacts in that place. It will be organized by experiment IDs. We will look at this later. And then once you had your computer cluster created, you just submit review and submit. Let's go to create a computer cluster. You can do this here directly, or also you can do it as well in compute. The location again. Try to use the same location that where you have the rest of your resources, dedicated or low priority. This is just for you, nobody can remove you. It will take into account only the quota that you had assigned at your subscription. Low priority is cheaper than dedicated, but how to say, there is some rules that where if there is a lot of demand and you had a low valorated subscription, you can the Azure may remove some of the pods that are assigned to you to your job, and can be delayed for a while after you there is resources again available to be used in this category. No, you can use CPU, GPU as well, and depending again on the quota, you may choose one of the some templates among those that are available. You click next, computer 9 OLO computer cluster or something like that. Vaya. Here I think there is a bug here. Let's create it, because this happened as well yesterday to me. Let's go here, config. Okay. So and later we will return to this. I don't know what happened there, but to me it's like a bug. Number of nodes, here you specify from a minimum of, obviously of 0 to a maximum of what you had available in your quota. And then if you specify 0, this means that this is pre-assigned to you, and when you run a pipeline or a job or an experiment, it will start the VN for you automatically, just when you do the submit. As I said before, depending on the number of nodes that you have here in this computer cluster, there is the possibility to parallelize the job. Azure Machine Learning will do it for you. There is also some jobs which are by nature running in parallel, like the hyperparameter tuning. You can use one node or you can use multiple nodes. The classes which govern the hyperparameter tuning are designed to send different experiment, different versions of the experiment with different parameters to the different available nodes that you had in your cluster. Here we just had one, so there is not much to choose. But again, having zero, when the cluster is healed, all the nodes go down after 120 seconds. This is the time to scale down. When the pipeline, the job demand to have more nodes because of the graph that is designed, the word graph designed by the internally by Azure, see that it's possible to parallelize the processing. It will automatically start another node and run the component in that node. If you specify here a number different than one, this means that you will have this node always running. What happened with that? Well, if you have obviously there is a cost on that. If you have a powerful machine always running, it will be a cost. At the time that you decide how to plan the infrastructure for your pipeline, for your model, you need to be aware of all these details. Again, here by default, and also if you are planning again to go into being certified by Microsoft, you need to know all these details because believe me, they will ask you this on the exam. Enable SSH, the same. Here, the same I say before with the computer instance, I don't use it. Usually these servers, they are fired up. They make the job, they run the component, they run the step, and then move to the next step, unless that you want to. So the life of the pod of the VM is very short, no? Unless that you are running a process that is taking days, and you need to access to the VM for any reason, I wouldn't say that not really necessary. But it's up to you. Depends on your case, no? We created. Now we are just creating one. Let's remove this in order not to have any problem, or even we can probably access here as well to show you before it's creating and before I remove it. I can show you the VS Code in depth. Yeah, well, for those that are familiar with that, it's pretty simple to use. Here I can also open VS Code automatically in my desktop. Is automatically connecting with that. It will do. Yeah, here is recommending you to install these tools I mentioned you before. If you want to work with that, it's pretty well integrated. You can do the login. You can run anything that you can do in the UI. You can do it here with the toolkit. I will show you later. But well. We can discuss this as well in another video. Okay, so let's close this. Okay. And now computer cluster is already done, so let's stop that at least. Sorry, probably it's because I had this connected. Well, let's try. It's not, something is blocking here. Just 1 second. Yeah, sorry, I just need to refresh. I will stop it at least to liberate some resources. I don't want to run into, as these services I'm just created for this purpose, for some other videos as well, and then I have not much quota here in this workspace. So better to stop it before we run into the designer. So let's take again this one of these examples. This is already an example. You can modify them if you want and make a copy and a custom example like you changing, for example, this. Probably it's better to just run one time, see how it works. We will see it now, and then on this side do the final yourself. Let's next. No input and output. Cluster computer, exactly. We just take that one, plot storage, and submit. That's simple than that. Once now, it's going to create a job. Once the job is created, you can access here and you go here to this place. While this is created, we jump quickly to the prompt flow. You can just do prompt engineering as a standard flow. Conversational chat flow. This is pretty similar if you are familiar with OpenAI or UI and with the service provided by them, or even with Vertex AI. With but those that saw my video about Vertex AI and Gemini, this is exactly the same. You can do here in the standard flow. You can interact with the language models or with code models. You can do kind of prompt engineering as well with a few shot, zero shot as well. In chat flow, interact with a bot or create your own bot, and evaluation flow. To be honest, this I didn't see what exactly is, but we're connected with the with prompt engineering. There is also multiple examples, the same that in the other that Google or Amazon. These services are fully very well documented, and you have multiple examples that you can simply read it, and probably they will give you some ideas about how to deploy the service in your or the service that you need to do to for your project. Okay, let's go to jobs. A regression test one. The service is running. Exactly. As you see here, the service is running. Now you see here, it's running the test. As I mentioned you before, well, this is reading the data. Probably they are running in the same, can run both activities on the same. But well, every time, so this means that they are activating the steps. Only when they are running, you will see them here in green. Sorry, when the finish is in green. Now, this, for example, that you see here is running. This is still waiting. So now we are just selecting some columns from the dataset, and then we will clean, blah, blah, blah. And then we will see later how it goes. Okay. So here you will see as well, we had all the activities is being recorded in the workspace. You had all the metadata you need to later track back or to understand what happened with your experiment. You had the settings, output, metrics you define. You can log metrics. Well, you can do everything you can imagine. You have even the code that is here. Well, in this case, as this is a component in the designer, you cannot have access to the code. But if you are using your, we'll see this in a different video. If you use your custom components, you will see here the code that is running in this specific component. Here images, if you are logging images because you are, for example, evaluating a model, etc., you will see here. So you had this per experiment or job, and you had as well this per component. We will look at later on when the job is finished how it looks like. Data, you can have access here not only to the storage accounts that you it was attached to when you create the component. You can here as well access to different resources. First of all, you need to have to create what they say data store. Data store is a link to a resource in in Azure can be block store, file share, data lake storage generation 1, generation 2, or databases. And then you create the link, and once you have the link, you create the data asset. The data asset can be a folder with multiple files, it can be multiple CSV files, JSON files, TXT files, it can be a table or multiple tables in a database, it can be whatever is in the data stores that you define in the previous section. And also here new, data set monitor, this is to do the monitoring of your model. You see that you may know that there is two ways to monitor your model. One is data drafting and the other one is model drafting. Here is monitor if the data that you are imputing to your model is having a significant variance in the statistics of the data. Then we can cover this in another video, but well, here is how you define, okay, send me an alarm to Application Insight when my data variance or the variance of this attribute change in 10%, for example. This kind of monitors you can set up here. And then this way, if you are receiving some data that the model didn't see before, at least you know that some data that maybe this is the reason of a poor performance or the data that you are or the prediction that are being done by or are produced by your model. Many times you will find that you will spend a lot of time explaining why the model give this prediction for what, and then these are just helpers that will help you when you have to do these kind of explanations. Machine Learning Studio has welcomed with some other tools to analyze fairness, bias, etc. We will look at this later on. Jobs, let's take a look how it's running this. Here is just the still running. Yeah, well, now as you can see, some of the steps are already done. Now it's training the model. So it's a simple linear regression. Here we are choosing the algorithm. Here we're splitting the data, cleaning data. Now training the model, scoring and evaluating. Let's move later. Component, this is a component registry. As any other technology like Databricks or Vertex AI or SageMaker, you have a repository where you, for example, design a component which is a model which is doing something, you are happy with that, you can register the component here, or for example, a specific splitting and imputing missing data with a specific algorithm, you can define this as a component and register here, and it can be used for any model or any pipeline that you design inside this workspace. Pretty useful, specialized if you want to mechanize and automatize the design of different models. This at the end, when you had multiple dozen of models, for example, dozen of pipelines, you may start to reuse components because it's not you may have hundreds of different custom components with probably they are in some cases with very small differences that this will allow you to build blocks which can be reused by different models or different pipelines. Well, this is essentially every job at the end, even if it is a single component, is running in a component of a higher hierarchy that is a pipeline job. The pipeline job is the run itself, and once you are happy with the performance or with the run of this pipeline job, you can define what they say a pipeline endpoint. The pipeline endpoint is just the metadata of this pipeline, and you can replicate this. It's just the metadata of the job that you can reuse as much as you want. So later on, you can take this endpoint and run it under a schedule or under an event, and run it with new data. This is pretty much what you are gonna do most of the time, running pipelines, first of all, during the design of the model, the job, or how, whatever, it can be a training job, a hyperparameter job, or can be a part ETL, inference, in batch, online, whatever. Once you finish with this job, you design a pipeline endpoint, and again, this pipeline endpoint can be reused via a trigger, which can be an schedule or can be an event. For example, somebody deposit a file in a block storage or in a event hub. You can see here that this is still running. Let's take a look again. Yeah, practically, well, it's completed. And now you can go to take a look, setting, let's check if this is registering some metrics. So the one second. Okay, sorry, it take a while. So as you see here, this component has established some metrics, and you can see here on the section metrics, also in the overview. So as you see here, there is plenty of information. All this information is logged in your storage, in the storage account that is attached to the workspace, and if the, well, if you decide to log, for example, other metrics, even images, if you are plotting something, all the activities that you may do in a notebook can be done here. Here, as I said before, this is a designer. Designer is a tool which allows you some flexibility and quickly prototyping, but doesn't have the full flexibility that had, for example, the custom components that I will show you in a different video. Here is a simple way to do a quickly prototype with the different components, pre-settled components, and then on you just link them, you just submit it, see the outcomes, and you can get a model running with some or some experiment running very quickly, maybe less some hours, and you can evaluate rapidly or quickly how your model how does it can perform. Here, let's return a little bit here. You will see that you have plenty of the machine learning algorithms, linear regression, Poisson regression, means clustering, multivars, well, yeah, exactly. So you can take a look. You have also analytics, Frotex, Engram, LDA. You had R, you had Python. So this is a custom scripts that you can introduce on the pipeline. So again, here you just drag and drop and connect the components. Again, for quick prototyping, this is probably a very good tool, the same that AutoML, even easier to use, but at the same time, the disadvantage or the con is here that you may see that it probably is 100 or 80% what you want, but there is some components that you need to create custom and according to the requirements of your project. In my experience, I used this tool for more than 3 years or 4 years almost, and then I never used this tool. I always create my own components and in using Python. You can do exactly the same with that. It's just more time consuming, but you have full flexibility in how to interconnect the different components. You can decide how to do the splitting, which algorithm use. It just need to do more coding, obviously, but most of the applications will need that kind of flexibility. at the end, it will depend mostly on the requirements of your project or your company. Okay, let's move to environments. Environments, as the name is pretty self-explanatory, it is a number of curated environments for different purposes. So just at the end of the day, or under the hood, everything is running in a container, in a Docker container, and every Docker container has a environment by default. You can decide per component, per state in your pipeline, which environment to use. So you want to use the first component, which is simply ATL or data labeling, for example, this, which comes only with Ubuntu and Python 3.9. If you want to use in your second or third, I don't know, you can use here, Open, MPI, and LightGBN, because this is the algorithm you want to use. This is an environment, which comes an Ubuntu 2002 with everything pre-configured, and you just need to import to download into the Docker during the configuration process. You just download to the or attach to this component the environment and the script that you want to run into it. And there is I don't know how many it could be, but probably there is 25 per page. Let me check. I don't know how many it is. Take a look. Again, probably everything that you did, you don't need to worry. For example, if you look at here, if you are okay with this, GPU, CUDA, probably this is coming as well with PyTorch. Labeling, yeah. So you can take a look here. PyTorch with MLSDK, blah, 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 blah. You can choose one of these, or additionally, you can create your custom one. Your custom one is essentially create a Docker file with a requirement file, a requirement TXT, and you can create your own environment, because maybe the what you need, you may need, I don't know, lifelines, for example, to do survival regression, and this is not available in any of the curated environments that you have available in Azure. Tip or advice from my side, usually I create my own environments and I run it attached to the different components depending on the need. For those components that are purely ETL or purely data transformation, I just simply install a Docker with Python to make it smaller and to run quickly, and for those that need specialized libraries, I just install what I need there. In some cases, for those that need GPU, but install the I may take one of these, and also something that you can do is take one of these that are already presetted and adapt it to your need. So you, this is the base of the environment, and you can install in top of that your libraries. So it's up to you, a lot of flexibility on how you can create environments and how to later on attach it to the different states in your pipeline. Models, this is a conventional model registry. Once you have trained your model and do the hyperparameter tuning, you may want to register your model for future use, and also for tracking or labeling of your model with different versions, and you can always keep track of how your model is evolving. And especially when you are going to deploy the model to production, is a good place to have everything localized and correctly labeled, because later on when you have to explain, okay, what is the traceability of this model, how it was trained, what was the performance of the model, blah blah blah, what is the different scripts that you use to train this model, everything is in is inside the workspace, and here you have your different versions of your model in a single location. Then also you can do like in other tools, you can download the model to another location and use it for inference as well. So it's a model repository, and the same as our software repository, you can keep here different versions of your models. endpoints, the saying that once you had you are happy with your pipeline, you see that all the components are working as expected, your model is performing correctly, you can decide to well, before now there is two new endpoints. One is Azure OpenAI for generative AI, and the one is serverless endpoint. Now you can integrate or deploy models into I forgot the name. One second. Into Synapse. Sorry. Into Synapse. And then instead to deploy to AQS, real-time endpoint is essentially deploying the endpoint and create an endpoint in AQS, but endpoint is creating in a container in a VM, and the way that they work is slightly different. Azure OpenAI is an endpoint which is going to have a generative model behind, and the serverless endpoint is just deploying the model into the other technology. Real-time endpoints is at the end is going to be a VM which is going to be running and waiting for a request to provide an inference on a prediction. Batch endpoint, it will be only activated based on a trigger. Most of the time, based on my experience, especially in big companies, most of the projects works in a batch flavor. You just receive some new information, you run the project, you run the pipeline, and you produce the predictions, and these predictions later on are consumed either directly by the user or are put it in a database or in a folder and then on presented by a front-end application. But real-time endpoints, well, again, few times we need to use this, at least based on my experience in the projects I worked before. But both of them are available. This again, usually behind the real-time endpoints is AQS, the Kubernetes service, managed Kubernetes service of the Azure. In behind batch endpoint, there is the VM service that are also available. Container service, ACS, Azure Container Service, that is equivalent to AQS, but well, orientated instead to have the Kubernetes, you have the VMs in the individual VMs on the available on the service. These two, to be honest, I didn't use it. They are really recent added to the tool, and then well, but Azure OpenAI is just to interact with the generative AI, and the serverless endpoint is with to interact with the technology we show here down. Compute, we already look at this. Computer Kubernetes clusters, again you can add here ACS or even a Kubernetes cluster now. Before it was only AQS, now you can also use your own Kubernetes cluster. Monitoring, here is here you decide, we saw this in data, you can here create your own monitors you can create your own monitors to monitor the performance of the model. You can define as well here how to do it, under schedule, when start, and also to who to send notifications, etc. Pretty useful, and especially as this tool is designed to cover all the steps, all the phases on the machine learning lifecycle, monitoring is essential part of the of the lifecycle of your machine learning application, you will need to monitor the model constantly up to the moment that you decide or is decided to retrain the model because the model is not already useful under the requirements that it was designed. Data labeling, well, this is a typical service that is provided by all these for the different cloud providers, that essentially to label the data and label data that you may use your workforce. You design a project here in the data labeling service that you want to label some data, and then on this data you define the rules, how it had to be labeled, can be some pictures, you had to decide which classes or which tag had these images, you can label documents. It's just a design, is a service inside Machine Learning Studio, which allow you to use a workforce, usually a third party company. You can use as well your own workforce inside your company to label data. Here you can go through a different step. You decide first of all how you want to label the data, then on you decide the just configure the workforce. Again, can be a specialized company, can be your own employees or your colleagues, and then on you send the data, you split the data into the different components of the workforce, and then on they label, they send you the labeled data, you send them feedback. The purpose of this component is just do that, no? Label and label data, and create a workflow to this for this purpose. And linked service, the integration with Synapse. I think it's all. That's all. I think we will cover in a different video specific components of the Azure Machine Learning Studio. The same I'm doing with the other cloud providers, with SageMaker and with Vertex AI. Also, we will look into the OpenAI Studio to see how to interact with the OpenAI models. Here there is pretty interesting components that we will cover in different videos, and that is for this video. I think it's enough. I hope that you like it. It's just an introduction to this technology, which in my opinion is quite well designed. Again, plenty of documentation available on Microsoft, a lot of examples. It's fully integrated with everything that is, it can be other way. It's fully integrated with Stories, Databricks, Synapse, Azure Data Factory, whatever, Azure DevOps as well. So everything that is inside Microsoft is fully integrated with the Machine Learning Studio. I use it for several years, in different clients, different industries, and I find that it's really, really help a lot. And also at the time that you need to explain how your model performs, there is other tools that we will cover, the how to evaluate fairness and bias. Everything is integrated here under a single service, a workspace. In my opinion, very well designed. I think you will enjoy, and you will find it as well very helpful. Okay, that's all. Thank you very much. Hope that you like it. And as I said many times, if you like it, just give me a like. And if you are not subscribed to the channel, it's now time to do it. Thank you very much. See you soon.